So it was. I'm going to start out with a story. It was the spring of 1989, and I was running a bank here in Houston, and I had a really hard day. It was one of our first acquisitions, and they put me in charge of it, and traffic was terrible, and everybody was upset because nobody wanted change, and I'm driving home in the Houston traffic, and suddenly I get a phone call, and it's the teacher of my daughter's preschool. And she was three, and this is a true story, by the way. And she said, "Bambi, are you going to pick up Brittany?" Now, I look at my watch, and it's 6:15, and the daycare closed at 6. And I'm about 45 minutes away. And so, I was like, "What? How could I have lost track of time that would have this happen?" So, of course, I'm frantic. I get through traffic as quickly as I could. I pull up to the daycare, and there are no lights on. And now I'm really frantic. And I'm like, what happened? Where's my daughter? And I walk inside, and in the rocking chair in the corner by a window is Miss Penny, my daughter's teacher, and she's rocking her. And they're just having a great time singing. And so as a mother, you can imagine, I'm beating myself up and I get in my car, and I'm saying, how could I have let this happen? Here I run a $100 million bank, and I'm questioning my ability to be a really great mom. And so what I discovered as I reflected on that was that I had a lot going on. So I was running a bank. I had 40 people at that location that I was accountable for. I was on two boards. I was teaching Sunday school. I had a husband. I had another child, right? And various other activities that I was participating in. Soccer mom, and my husband was the Cub Scout leader. And what I realized is that I had a lot of balls in the air, and that I expected that I would keep them all in the air, and that I would do them, not only get them done, but get them done right. Now, I don't know that you've been late to pick up your child at daycare before, but I suspect you're shaking your head. I'm not going to ask for a raise of hands, but I suspect that you've had things in your life drop through the cracks. The thing that we're going to start to look at today and is, what are the things that you have? And so if we look at the things that you're balancing, so I'd like you to look for yourself. What are some of the things that you're balancing? So you have internal and external clients. I'm suspecting most of your clients are internal. Yeah, there's emergencies, and then there's interruptions that you have to deal with, right? And there's your team, and there's your health, and your exercise, and your nutrition. And then there's recreation and fun when we get time to that, although some days we're like, well, what's that? Then we have our family. We may have children, or we may have friends, or we have spouses, our parents that we need to take care of. We've got our network that we want to be connected to. What about things in our community, volunteering? And then maybe even our spiritual activities. So I'm just wondering for you, I'd like for you to take a moment and think about, what are some of the things you're juggling? Do you feel like you have a lot that's going on in your life? So I'd like to hear from you. What are some of the things that you juggle, that you feel like you're juggling?
Four kids, five and under.
Four kids, five and under. Wow. Wow. Yeah. That's incredible. God bless you. Four kids, five and under. That's great. What a blessing. But that's a lot. I mean, I didn't make it with two, so, I mean, I made it, but, What else? What are you juggling? Oh, and by the way, on top of that, I was running a bank, right? So I had to run on top of that. So you've got really responsible jobs, or you wouldn't be in this room. And then you've got all the other stuff. Have you ever dropped out something that was important to you?
Yes.
Yes? Now, I'm not going to ask you to, confess right now, but what do you think is the source of that? If you were going to step back and look, what's possibly the source of that?
Time management.
Now, how many hours of the day do we have?
24.
Are we going to get more? If I could come in here and give you 48, I'd be a rich woman, wouldn't I? It's like, okay, now we're going to give, because I don't know about you, but even when that happened, I was certified in the Seven Habits, so I'm a learning junkie, and so I was certified in the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, right? I had every gadget there was. I had my bag phone back then. I don't know if any of those are old enough to remember, but we had the cell phone, was this big bag, right? I thought I was really cool. And so I was working all the way to work and home, you know, getting up a little bit earlier, staying a little bit later, yeah, trying to get it all balanced. And so I'd like you to consider there are a lot of habits and strategies that you have adapted to try to get it all done. And Mission Control, what we're going to do today is Mission Control, the Productivity and Accomplishment Workshop, is designed for working in the 21st century. So many of us learn to work in another time. I don't know about you, but when I first started working, and I'm pretty sure I'm the oldest person in the room, we had a physical inbox and a physical outbox. We didn't have email. Right? Really? Some of you are like, what? What would that be like? We didn't have the internet when I first started working. And if I got 6 or 7 letters done a day, that was a pretty good day. 6 or 7 letters. So my assistant would come in and she'd dictate, and you know, they used to do that really funny, I never learned that, but the dictation? Shorthand. Okay, shorthand. And so she would shorthand, she would type it up on a typewriter. She'd come in and I'd read it and I would mark it up and she'd go type it again, right? And then when it got really good, we got the Selectric typewriters that would back up and erase it for you, right? And in fact, when we left the bank, my assistant came with me and she said, I'm not leaving my typewriter. But you got a computer. Now, I don't think she's ever used it, but she just, you know, she just couldn't quite let go of that typewriter. And, you know, so what we got done in a day back then, and you know, if you just told me I only got 7 letters done, number one, I don't even have my assistant do my letters anymore, right? We just send an email. No, we just send text, don't we? I mean, who's written a letter to somebody lately? You have? Good for you. Yeah, good for you. I got some nice ones in my Christmas cards. Yeah, you too?
Yeah, I wrote a Christmas letter.
You wrote a Christmas letter. Huh? Is that what you were talking about, too, a Christmas letter?
Personal letters?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, but it's rare that, you know, we're like 2 people in the room. That's rare. Because why? I mean, I just sent a text, right? Anthony needed something. I didn't call Brenda. I didn't send her an email. I just said, can you do this? Boom. So we are connected 24/7. You're sitting in your desk, or you're sitting at home eating dinner, and email's coming in, right? And voicemails are happening. And information for you to read's happening. All the time. So the time has changed, and one of the things, even if you are in the younger generation, you're born into the society and the behaviors of those of us that were here, the baby boomers and the traditional generation. So you got born into our way of doing things in organizations. And so you're probably got 1 feet in both worlds. But still, I suspect that, do we need to change?
No.
Okay. So still I suspect that you're dealing with, because I haven't found anybody that didn't feel like this. Mm-hmm. Are there days where you feel like this? Mm-hmm. It's like, how am I going to do it? You know, I forgot to pick my child up on time. Yeah, that's what I look like. So again, the one thing I'd like you to consider is we actually don't confront that we only have 24 hours in a day. Because when you get up in the morning and you have your to-do list, do y'all keep to-do lists? Everybody keep a to-do list? When you look at that to-do list, is the expectation that you're going to get that done today? Or do you have a certain number that you say, these I'm going to do today? What do you do? What is your practice around your to-do list? Expect to get it done. And how often, Cherie, do you get done what's on your to-do list? Hardly ever. Yeah. Why do you think that is? I really want y'all to think. So this is, I really want you to think. Why is it? How many of you, every day, you get done what's on your to-do list? You go home, and it's like, everything's wonderful. I now can play with my children, see my friends. Other things pop up. Very good. Other things pop up. Very good. What else? What else happens?
Life.
The school calls and says this, or mother calls and says that, right? Or a friend calls and says, I need help here. Or the community calls and says, oh, well, I need you to do this for us. Right? Life happens. But I'd like you to consider, we don't work like we only have 24 hours a day. And we're going to deal with that today. Because if you, for you to have a breakthrough, which Mission Control, by the way, what's available through this program is actually a breakthrough in your productivity and accomplishment. Now, and this program is for individuals. Now, I know you're going to be focused on work because that's where we spend a high percentage of our time. But this is also applicable to your home. I know one day I had a friend and I was telling her everything I was going to do. I was going to pay nine holes of golf. I was going to paint a bedroom. I was going to go to the movies with my kids and something else. And she said to me, and she knew I led Mission Control, and she said, can you really do all that on the weekend? Nine holes of golf, which takes what? A half a day? Hours, right? Painting a bedroom, which I'm not good at anyway, and cleaning it up and moving the furniture. I mean, that's probably a day, right? Going to the movies with my kids. Now, you got to figure I got to take a shower and I got to eat and I got to go to the bathroom and all those other things. When I actually confronted how much time that was going to take, it was 4 days. Like when I really told the truth about, you know, go to church, right? So I had to include that in there that I hadn't had on my list. And I told Grandma I'd come by and, you know, bake her some cookies. And I didn't have that on the list. So I'd like you to consider we don't confront reality. And the opportunity to have a breakthrough in terms of time and productivity, is the first step is to really get in touch with reality. And that's one of the things I'm committed that you have today. Does that work for you? Okay, good. So Mission Control says give a lift to your life and send your productivity into orbit. And that's not a sales conversation. That's what people say when they implement the system. You know, and I struggled when I started preparing for today. It's like, how do I give it all to you? You know, I want to give it all to you in an hour and a half so you leave with everything you have to really, you know, make a difference. So I've struggled with what can I give that would make the biggest difference? But once we get it done, and we are going to get it done over time, right? We'll see. We'll see how this goes, right? I think you'll have, it's a sense of relief. And I have to tell you, Mission Control was created by a guy who was with Daytimers. And I don't know if you remember Daytimers, but they were the company that made calendars, paper and to-do lists. In fact, actually, it was a paper company. And then Covey bought it. And I think now maybe, I don't know if Franklin Covey is still in business. You can buy day planners, right? And so the guy that was in charge of new products actually is the guy that started the design for this program about, I don't know, I did it in 2000. So it was 10 years before that. So it was about 1990. And what happened was he surveyed 40,000 people a month. And one of the things, no matter how many, they had 175 to-do lists, 175 different designs. So I had one with pansies, I remember. I had to have a pretty one, right? So, but what he found was that no matter how many of the tools that they bought that he had, and no matter how many programs they went to, people were complaining about being overwhelmed, being stressed, and lack of balance, and worrying about things falling through the cracks. And so he set out to really create a breakthrough for people in that. And so this program is a result of that. In fact, at one point he created a new product that was going to take your to-do list and move it from day one to day two automatically for you so you didn't have to. So everything you didn't get done moved. And what do you think happened at the end of the first week?
Nothing.
Well, the system crashed because all their customers, right, you imagine, they didn't expect the volume of that they had to deal with because things weren't coming off the list. In fact, the average person has 23 items on their to-do list. They attempt 2.5, and they get 1.2 done. Now, I know you're not average, right? But it still tells you that we're higher, yeah. But it still also tells you what we're dealing with. You know, this was 40,000 people a month. So we're not just talking about a couple people we asked about. And so now, it really is going to take something for you to get something out of this, right? You're going to have to look to see what would you be interested in. So I'd like you to start thinking about, as I go through the next few slides, what value would you want to get out of this conversation today? You know, if you could have a breakthrough, let's just pretend like we could have a miracle. I like to have miracles. So let's pretend like we could have a miracle in your productivity just from an hour and a half. What would that look like for you? If we're now together, we're high-fiving, we're like, wow. What would you want to accomplish? So I've said this, Mission Control is the foundation and fundamentals for a breakthrough in productivity and accomplishment. What you'll get is the energy and the vigor of intense personal commitment. The ability to focus. Have you ever been working on something or somebody comes in your office and you don't hear a word they say because you're working on something else? Have you ever had that happen? Or have you been in somebody's office and you're clear they didn't hear a word you said? That's probably what we're most I get to the point where I'll say, well, let me come back. You know, because I'm, you know, why does that happen? Because we got all those plates in the air and we're trying to get it all done. The ability to give all of yourself. You know, I did some research on, you know, I'm interested in human performance, and I did some research on the impact of being able to focus. And one of the things that the U.S. did this study on was actually manufacturing. And they said billions of dollars are spent in rework. I think it's not just manufacturing, by the way. And the number one reason was people didn't listen. And I don't think it's because we don't want to listen. I don't think people, do you? I don't think people intentionally don't want to listen. I think we have a lot going on and we don't have something to get our arms around all of it. And then a powerful way of dealing with what you're not dealing or not handling. We're not going to be able to touch that piece today, but we are going to touch some of the others today. So we're going to talk a little bit today about your work habits. That's one aspect. We're going to talk a little bit about your unseen assumptions. And we're going to give you, at least give you one of the tools of the Mission Control System. There's six tools of the system. Most of the time when we deal with time, we deal with our infrastructure and tools, right? Our calendar, our book, our you know, phones. And those are important, and those are part of the system. But by themselves, we find makes no difference. And then there's the second domain that we impact in this program, which is work habits. So it's how do we work? And in many cases, we don't even question our work habits because they're habits. It's just what we do. And so sometimes our work habits, even when you see them, you know they don't work. We still do them, right? And so we're going to look a little bit at some of your habits. And hopefully yesterday, if you had a chance to at least think about, I know you had one day to think about it on top of everything else to do, maybe some of the things you noticed. In fact, I should ask that now. What did you notice? Anybody notice anything just from noticing what's going on in your day? Anthony, you're smiling. Interruption after interruption. Yeah. What percentage of your day do you think was interruptions? 65%. And what were the interruptions? What were you doing during those interruptions? We got to raise. We got to raise hand. Yeah. So people needing help or getting your ideas or, yeah, yeah. Anybody else see a high percentage of interruptions? When we manage, Pamela, you're smiling. What did you notice?
My kids were older, so I get a lot from
them. Yes, everybody has to talk. Gets to talk to you when they come by. Yeah. Okay. Good. Who else?
I know that I allow myself to interrupt myself.
Uh huh.
Because I'm thinking about something else that I need to do.
Yes. Yes.
And so, and then, you know, that ends up more time spent on what you were working on.
Yeah.
So
you notice that you interrupt yourself. Anybody ever be on your email and then all of a sudden Nordstrom's pops up, the shoes that you were looking for last time you were online? I don't know my system, but, you know, and then all of a sudden it's like, shoes. I know I need shoes. So then I click on the shoes, right? And then I go to, next thing I know, they got dresses on sale. So now I've gone to the dresses, and now I think about a friend that I want to see, maybe a concert I want to go to that I could wear that to, right? And so then I go research the concert, and then 30 minutes later, maybe I'm back to my work again. Anybody had that experience? I know we can't. I know. No hands, right? I don't know. But that happens. It happens. It does happen. We're not getting Hallie smiling at me. Yeah, so being aware of your work, just starting to pay attention to your work habits will make a difference. There was a productivity guy. Toshiba's one of my clients, and there was a productivity expert there this year and this past year. And he said, which I hadn't heard this, that when the studies that he saw show that when you're interrupted and you're doing something, that many times you don't even go back to it the same day. You don't even go back to it to the next day, which I hadn't shaking your head. I hadn't heard that. But that's what his research showed, that we don't even go back to it that day. Yeah, yeah. Now, that doesn't mean we're going to stop. Are we going to be able to stop interruptions?
No.
But we can start to be more cognizant of interruptions and some practices we can take on. In fact, I haven't included that, but we can talk about that at the end of the day because I think that'll be a valuable piece. Another client we did mission control with was a health safety environmental group, and they're a group that typically have a lot of green and yellow energy, like to be together, like to talk, and they created the first 10 minutes of the hour as interruption time. Now, that doesn't mean I still can't come to you. And if I need something from Pam, that doesn't mean I gotta wait till the next, 10 minutes of the first hour. But the stuff that's not critical, they wait. And so that everybody knows, and I see those guys, I probably did that with them, I don't know, 8 years ago. And when I see them out in public, which I do, they'll say, we're still doing that 10 minutes. So there may be some practices as you let this kind of marinate, some of the conversations we have today. There may be some practices that you guys see that you can put in place for your team that can help. Because we can't say, because interruptions aren't necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes it feels like a bad thing because I'm not getting my work done. But the truth is, you're going to get interrupted. And if I had project work that I planned to do during that time, it ain't going to happen. So if we're dealing with reality, remember what I said? The start of a breakthrough starts with getting into reality. If you're going to have a breakthrough, by the way, in anything, access to a breakthrough is getting in reality. And so starting to get into reality about time. Am I really going to do this? Is this really? I'm a person that likes to say yes. And I said yes to a project one time, and I went to the HR conference that year, the time HR was under me, and I had told my boss I'd get that done in 90 days. And I found a lady at the conference who that was her job full time. And I've now promised it in 90 days. All right, so I had no idea what it was going to take. So you want to start to look at what's it really going to take. Because the truth is, you're not getting it all done anyway. I know you don't believe me, but we're going to look at that. Now, the last piece that really helps with the breakthrough of the program is the context. So it's the context is the surroundings. If you look in the dictionary, it's the surroundings, the conditions, the circumstances. And it's, it's what even what we say, the climate. And we have a context around time, don't we? What do you think the context is around time? I know I'm making y'all think. If somebody asks you to do something, do you have to do it? Is there yes the answer?
Depends on who's asking.
Depends on who's asking. Very good. Yeah, it depends on who's asking. But even with who's asking, is it possible always to get done what that person's asked? Yeah.
Well, we think it is.
Yes.
It's just not right now, but
yes. Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah. And so the thing you want to start to look at, I mean, would you rather have somebody say, Chris, I'm not going to be able to get that done today, but I can get it done on Friday. Will that work for you? Would you rather me say that to you or say yes and not do it, not get it done? Because I know as supervisors and managers, what your people, and what you said, it depends on who's asked, what your people think is if you make a request that they have to say yes. Now, I'm not saying, you just say no to everything. I mean, we do have to keep our jobs. But what I want you to start to look at is what's it really going to take? Because the truth is, it's not getting all done. Look at your to-do list. I was with the guy this morning, and he said, I've got something on my to-do list from 6 months ago. And I said, well, are you ever going to do that? Just take it off. Or tell the person that you said you're going to do it. Now, this doesn't mean you don't be responsible. It doesn't mean, well, Bambi says we can just not do it. No, I'm not saying that. You do need to be responsible for the person that you work with and say, let's talk about it. Let's talk about what's on my plate. You know, are there ways I'm doing it that's taking me longer than I should? Am I overanalyzing? Which I think could be a challenge in somebody that's in this the kind of role you're in. And if we look at the color energy in the room, we have a lot of blue and green energy. I actually gave you all a color wheel of your team, and we'll talk a little bit about insights at the end. But this is who's in the room, except for Scott. So if you look at who's in the room, a lot of blue and green energy. So a lot of analyzing and liking to look in the details and, you know, making sure I have enough information. I don't know, because I don't know how to do your roles, but you want to start to look. Am I overkilling it? I know when I ran a banker, we had loan officers that never could have enough information to decide. And you can't run a bank if you're not making a loan. And in the case of loans, as you guys know, it's risky. Now, we have to be accurate pretty high for a bank not to fail. But at some point, you got to decide when you have enough information to make a decision. And sometimes some of us have to look at that. Now, so your context is created by your thoughts, assumptions, and what you say over and over again. I'm too busy. Some people say I'm too busy. Some people say I'm swamped. I was telling Mike this morning that I had started saying I'm not a banker. I was a banker for 25 years. And I've been saying I'm not a banker. Now, I'm not working in a bank. But I related like I have no idea what's going on in the bank. And I just got hired to coach one of the leaders here in town. Oh my gosh, I'm a banker. But I've been saying the context that got created by my words was I'm not a banker. And that's not true. I know how to build a great bank. I'm just not doing that right now. That's not what I want to do. I don't want to go to work for a bank. I don't want to consult a bank, absolutely. But I wouldn't have even done that because what we say closes off possibility. And I had forgotten, but the person I was coaching was like, oh my gosh, this is so helpful that you're a banker. And all of a sudden I saw it. It's like, oh, I am a banker. You want to notice what you say to yourselves. What do you say to yourself about time? Now, and the context, whatever you say is decisive. Like me saying I'm not a banker, decided my actions. I never tried to get a client that was a banker. If somebody asked me to speak, I didn't go after speaking engagements that were banks. And then I hired a coach recently, and she said on my speaking piece, and she said, you need to target banks. And I knew intellectually that made sense because she'd researched me on the internet and saw how much, you know, I was on the board of the bank. I had a lot of it, 25 years. And so I heard her, and I thought, well, yeah, that's, you know, I'm going to honor that. It's a smart thing. But internally, I'm like, oh, that's not fun. I don't know how to do that. And all of a sudden, I realized me saying I'm not a banker had driven all of that. And by the way, you have conversations around time that decide what you see. By the way, that limits what's possible. You know, before the person, how fast can they run a mile now? It's like under 4 minutes. How much is it? That's awesome. Yeah, me too. I think it's under 4 minutes, but I remember when they broke the 8 minute. They didn't think you could do below 8 minutes. And then somebody did that. And then suddenly, but the context was, oh, nobody can run faster than 8 minutes. And then somebody did it. And then somebody ran under 7 minutes. And then and then they were, okay, well, nobody can go under 7 minutes. Because we start limiting by what we say. So I want you to have, my coaching would be, have a heightened awareness of what you say.
Accountants don't have a life.
Ah, is that one of the conversations about accountants?
We're here, we have to work.
If we're here, we have to work overtime. Yeah, what else? What else is the conversation about accountants? What if you actually could get your work done and not have to work overtime and not sacrifice on the excellence? Wouldn't that be great? Listen, if you took that on and said, I'm going to figure out how to do that, you'd figure it out. Now, I don't know how, and you're like, well, how in the world do you know, baby? You know nothing about accounting. I know, I look at the reports, right? But I suspect if you look, there are things that you're doing that you don't need to be doing. There's things that you could delegate. So if you took that on, you didn't say you were going to take that on, but I got inspired by it.
Not right now.
Don't hold me to that. But you know what I'm saying? If you just took it on as, I'm just going to take it on in 2016 to see what could I do to have me be able to get, you know, I will tell you, at one point I used to work 7 or 8 o'clock at night at the bank, and I thought that's what I had to do. And then I had these incidents like, you know, not picking up my kid on time, or, and one day I said, I'm not working past 5 o'clock. And I went and I told everybody on the leadership team, I'm not working. Now, everybody wasn't working as late as I was, right? I think maybe I said 6. I don't know what it was. But I'd get in like at 7 in the morning, and I said, 6 o'clock at night, if I can't get it done by then I'm not effective. And I want you to know, doesn't mean there's not some times when I didn't have to work on weekends, and right, you do what you have to do. But as a general rule, I went home at 6 o'clock, and I want you to know, I somehow figured out how to get it done. And I don't even know what I cut out. I probably didn't go look at the Dillard shoes, right, or the Nordstrom shoes. You know, and I probably didn't visit as much, and maybe my lunch, you know, but I it's been a while now, but and it's funny because when I told everybody else, they're like, okay, they're like, you know, who cares? Yeah, what's the big deal? But for me, it was a big deal. It's like, I'm not doing that anymore. Probably need to change it now with my company because I work a lot now. But I, you know, you have more capacity than you think. Now, so let's look at, I asked you a minute ago to start thinking about what would you want to accomplish. So there's real value in committing to a breakthrough in advance of any evidence that I'll be able to provide anything for you. But I'd like for you to take a moment and look to see, you're good there. What value breakthrough are you committed to for yourself out of this conversation today? And we're not putting it on your performance review so that you're going to be evaluated by it. This is something that you say, if I took it on, if I really did, and by the way, you may fail at it. And I may fail at delivering. But I can promise you it isn't going to happen for sure unless I create something. So I'd like to take a moment, and you have a pad. All of you have a red pad except for Allie. I apologize. I miscounted. I'd like you to write down, what is it that... Oh, you have one too? He's got one. Oh, we got lots of. She's got one. Thank you. You're going to want these red pads too. They're a tool. They're actually a tool for mission control. So, but I'd like you to write down, you know, if we're not talking 6 months from now and we're all sitting down just sharing what you got from this conversation today and you were delighted, what would you have gotten? When I started out today, I said, remember we have 24 hours in a day? If something's going to happen, and this is kind of like a little but it's just too perfect to not talk about it, is that if it's going to happen, there's got to be time in your schedule for it to happen. That's why when somebody has 23 items on their to-do list, or 10 even, or even 5 that I've chosen, and then at the end of the day, we haven't done them, and then in many cases, we may feel like, well, I didn't accomplish what I wanted to today. So we don't feel accomplished, although we probably did a lot of great things, like the interruptions that you had, Anthony, were probably things where you did a lot to people. But in your own experience is not that I accomplished a lot. And so the reason that we've discovered that people don't get those things done is because they haven't scheduled the things that matter and accounted for interruptions and emergencies and the things that come up. You know, when I did this at the bank, we did mission control while I was still in banking. One of the office managers came in with a session of our leadership team, a session from mission control, and she said, well, Bambi, I get interrupted between 9 and 4 all day long, every day between 9 and 4. And I said, well, what are you doing between 9 and 4? What are those interruptions? Well, I'm handling employee issues, and I'm taking care of customers. Well, what is your job? Handling employee issues and taking care of customers. So interruptions aren't necessarily a bad thing, although we do interrupt each other a lot. And there's a tool in mission control, which I'll just highlight real quick, because again, I think it's useful, and it's called agendas. an agenda is, so if she, Zeeshan, did I say right? Zeeshan works for me, Zeeshan, or I work for you. Every time, and I have, I lead with yellow energy. We know we've talked about the color energies. So every time I have a good idea, I want to tell him about it. So every time I walk by his office, he's like, let me tell you what I just thought, what we can do, it would be so great. And, you know, he's working on something. And by the way, when you're working on something complex, which all of you do in your roles, do you know how long it takes your brain to get back where it was when you got interrupted? How long do you think it takes? Nope. 29 minutes. Well, actually, it's 19 to 29 minutes, depending on how complex it was. That's why I think people don't go till the next day, because I'm like having to go spend that time to go back. Now, where was I, and what had I already looked at? And so, if you can start eliminating interruptions, reducing them. Some of them you're going to have. So one of the practices to do this, I'm going to go ahead and tell you about it now, even though I didn't have it on the agenda because I think it's important, is to create agendas with people who work with you. And so every time so how does it work? Every time I have an idea that I want to talk to Zeeshan about, if it's not absolutely emergency, which most things aren't, I capture it on my agenda. And then once a week or once a day, depending on how often we need to talk, I have an agenda meeting with Zeeshan, and I go over my agenda items. And by the way, he goes over his agenda items for me. And what you do is you train the people that work with you, and you can tell them, look, at every time, because you're probably interrupting them as much as they interrupt you, right? And so if you tell them, look, every time you have an idea or something you want to talk to me about, captured in your agenda, you can create a spreadsheet for it, however you want to do that. And then when we meet, we'll go over the agenda items. The important thing there, though, is that you actually have a meeting that you keep. So if I do my agenda and then Zeeshan cancels the meeting every time, I'm going to just start interrupting him all the time. But if you say, look, every time I say to my, and I do it with some clients, by the way, the ones that call me regularly, I'll say, look, every time I interrupt you, every time I call you or you call me, it takes 19 to 29 minutes. So I want to manage that so that I don't mess with you getting what we want accomplished. So let's schedule the time for a call. And then you keep track of the things you want to talk about. We had a software company that I worked with Mission Control. They reduced their time from new products to market in half. So a new product used to take a year. It takes less than 6 months now. And what they attribute it to is to telling the truth about time and managing interruptions. And the CEO of the company, I can't tell who it is because you would know, he said what he discovered was that he's interrupting all of these guys that are doing all this creative work. So he had all this, you know, that was his people to talk to. Probably had a lot of yellow energy at the time. I wasn't doing the color energies. But I think a lot of it had to do with him disciplining himself from every time he had a good idea that he went to talk to people. I did that very quickly. Is that clear? Yeah. By the way, it's a great management tool also. You can manage people's accountability with you that way. And the critical piece is that you actually schedule the time and the person, you know, with the person. You know, Brenda, my assistant, and I have reoccurring agenda meetings because I interrupt her all the time. And so she knows that every Monday we have our agenda meeting, and every Wednesday, and then a couple of times when I'm in the car, she knows when I'm in the car I want to talk. So she plans her time to listen to me while she's in the car because she's very introverted and, you know, I'm very extroverted. And so we have some, you know, like urgent agenda items that might show up between and then and now. And I quit interrupting her. So you come to our office, before I was talking to her all day long. How did she get anything done? 19 to 25 minutes when you're in purposeful, like detail work. And she does our accounting and she does QuickBooks for us and she schedules. I mean, she does detail work. Any questions you have about that? It's called agenda items. But it starts to reduce the interruptions. And a couple other things about that. is also if I send you an email. So say I work for Chris and I have this idea. Now, instead of meeting with Chris, because now we've created our agenda items, I'm going to email him. What about this, Chris? Rather than an email is also an interruption. So you train him instead of emailing me. Or you may say, what are the things that are urgent? We agree upon what are the urgent things. What do I want to know right away? Because I don't want you sitting there waiting. Right? That's not helping productivity. But what are some things that it what you know, you might even have a conversation about. Let's talk about what that might look like. Because they may not know. For them, everything. You know, I used to think everything was urgent until I started paying attention to actually very little. Unless the building's on fire, right, or somebody's fixing to hurt themselves, not much else is that urgent. But unfortunately, or fortunately, we're in a now society. We go to Starbucks, we want our coffee like that. We send an email, we want a response like that. So we have conditioned ourselves, so we interrupt ourselves all day long. And by the way, every time that you get interrupted with your phone, you hear the ding, you've interrupted yourself. So I recommend that you turn off all of the, you know, like the little thing when the email pops up or the, you know, when you see something on your calendar, notifications. I recommend you turn off notifications. Why? I don't know about you, but I'll see an email and I'll go, oh, they want to talk to me. Click. And then I'm down on a whole other path. Now I've just diverted myself. So my recommendation is you turn off notifications, text noises. Unless there's some reason, like you've got, you know, you're a parent and you're worried about, and you may set up with your family and your support group. You know, how do you get to me if it's an emergency? So that you're not having to manage everything as an emergency. Is that clear? Try it on. You start to do those things, you start to see, I actually can. I mean, think about how many times a day you got interrupted and you had to go back and rethink again. What if you actually could cut that in half? Average person that implements mission control saves 13 to 24 hours a month. What could you do with that? No, actually, it's a week. It's a week. What could you do with that? You could work out. Go do something fun. All right, so let's look. We're starting to talk about work habits. Here's some possible work habits. So just start to notice your work habits. Somebody walks into your door, you stop what you're doing and talk. Something comes up you need to remember, you jot it on a handy scrap of paper. Anybody recognize that? Or you say to yourself, I'll remember that. Someone asks you to do something, you say yes, but you don't check to see if you have time in your calendar to do it. Your phone rings while you're doing something without a second thought, you answer it. So we interrupt ourselves as much as anybody else. Now, in some jobs, we have to do that, right? You'll have to look. An email arrives in your inbox, you stop what you're doing and read your email, interrupting ourselves. And something you need to do comes to mind, you tell yourself, I'll remember it later, and you let it slide by. And how many of those things do you think we remember? You ever wake up at night like, oh, yeah. Yeah. So you want to start to notice your habits. We're just going to touch it a little bit today. Anybody see yourself in some of these? Yeah? All right, good. So with a partner, identify at least one of your current work habits that you say limits your productivity. It could be your email. It could be a voicemail. It could be interruptions and emergencies or meetings. Tasks or to-dos, what do you see you could possibly, just like if you're wondering, like investigating, what could possibly be impacting your productivity in the area of your habits? So I want you to take a moment, just have a minute to think about that. Get with your partner. What do you see? So how do our work habits create stress and lack of balance? The workplace around us is changing every day. Now, this is a map, which I love. Can you all see that back there? This is a map that talks about when things actually came into existence. And so in the late 1800s, there was trains and standardized time zones. Now, this wasn't when they were invented. This was where they were actually in regular use, where people used them. And by the way, it used to take a lot more time, obviously, to have people implement things than they do today. It used to take, 5 or 10 years to implement a new technology. Today, right, we get our smartphones, we get our new iPhones, we get our new iPads and we're doing it in 24 hours, right? But it used to take a lot more time for things to get into the mainstream because we just didn't accept it like we do now. So there was, in the 1800s, there was the trains and the automobiles came into the late 1800s. In the 1900s, there were mass assembly lines and mass production. In the 50s, there were U.S. interstate highway system. In the 60s, there were Sputnik and the space race. There was electronic typewriters, touch-tone digital phones in the 60s. In the 70s is when we got mainframe computers and personal fax machines. Remember the computers, I don't know, those have been around a while. The computers were huge, right? And then we got affordable flying in the 80s, if you say it's affordable. Then we got personal computers. We didn't get personal computers until the middle of the 80s. And cell phones was in the late 80s, early 90s. I remember 89, I had my bag phone, this big old chunky thing. And you know, unless other people, I guess, I don't know. That's a whole other story. Then in the 90s is when we got email. We didn't get email till the 90s. And then broadband internet and instant messaging and GPS. And then in the 2000s, we got Wikipedia, Wi-Fi, online streaming, webinars, podcasts, social media, smartphones, voice over IP, smart TVs, and we could probably add another 50 things to that list. And in many, when you first started working, it could have been at a very different time. Now we got drones, and we've got, now they're talking about, you know, eye recognition, and I mean, I don't even know what all they have. I'm not, you know, I don't know what all they have, but it's changing. And we're expected, by the way, from the 1990 to 1991, there was more information published as all prior recorded history. So you can get on the internet and read about anything and dwell it, you know, dig into it. And, you know, and back in these times, we didn't have that access. We couldn't get distracted, and now suddenly we want to read a book, and now we're going to study that country that's talked about in the book and then go down that path, because the world has changed. And so one of the things I suggest is you give yourself a break, because you're expected to manage the complexity in a very different time that's changing on us all the time. I'm working with a client right now, and the technology leader has not kept up, and he's going to lose his job. And I don't even know how anybody in tech, now he really does probably need to go to a smaller company, but, you know, can you imagine being in technology and trying, I mean, look at what you guys, the regulations, I mean, how quickly are those changing? I guess every time we have a new administration, for sure. Maybe not.
Well, more.
More. Yeah. So you can't sit still. So on top of your job, you got to keep up. Right, you got to keep your certificate. You know, it's just, there's just a lot, right? So the speed, complexity, and volume of information we're expected to process has exploded. And our work habits are not correlated to that, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, they're not. And here's a survey. Now, this survey has been done quite a while back. I keep looking for a new one, but I think the numbers are much higher, you tell me. People work an average of 45 hours a week, and they consider 16 of them as unproductive. I think that 45 has gone up, hasn't it? You think it's gone up on average? Don't know. People spend 5.5 hours in meetings each week, and 71% feel those meetings are unproductive. Y'all talked about meetings here. So 31% of their surveyed said they're using proven scheduling techniques, and still 66% said they don't have work-life balance. So it's not that we're not using the tools. And workers say they receive an average of 56 emails a day. I think that's higher. Depends on your job. And the top productivity pitfalls are procrastination, 42%, lack of team communication, 39%, and ineffective meetings, 34%. This was a 2005, 10 years ago. I don't think it's gotten better, do you? Yeah. So, you know, this isn't personal to you. We're living in this day and age. How do we be responsible for our reaction to that and still have a life that matters to us? Now, so let's talk about the habit of not confronting the totality of what you have to do and handle. Remember I said a breakthrough starts with getting in touch with reality. So what we're going to do is I want you to get your, we're going to get your handouts out, your workbooks out in a second. And I want you to, we're going to go through some lists of things to jog your memory. And as I jog your memory, I want you to write down anything there is for you to personally do or handle. Too much to write. Discouraged. Yeah, it gets discouraging. Yeah, what is the experience when you start to confront everything? Overwhelm. It is, isn't it? Yeah, and where is all those things captured right now? In your head. In fact, let's take a quick break and do a quick exercise. Where do you keep track of all this stuff? You have a thing called your everything inventory, or your existence structure inventory. Where do you keep track? So I want you to take a moment, and I want you to write down, where do you personally, any one of the places or methods that you use to keep things you do to do and handle in existence. So I want you to go through and check, where are the places or methods that you keep track of the things that you have to do or handle? A steno pad works perfectly. So when anything comes to mind, you write down, just like you started. You started that, when you started capturing the things to do or handle, you started capturing the things in one place. So anytime something new to do or handle comes to mind, you captured it. So the practice is, you captured into one and only one capture tool. Now, you can use a steno pad, which I brought you today because that works, low-tech works. You know, I happen to use the notes section in my phone. And so when I have something to do, in fact, Anthony saw me do that whenever I asked him, I put a note to remind myself to check on Brenda, and then I text Brenda to do it. So now when I get back, I have it captured in my agenda for Brenda to say, did you do what you promised with Anthony? So the important thing is that you have it with you when things come to mind. And where do things come to mind to do or handle?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. So the important piece is that you pick something that you can be reliable to have with you everywhere. And you can, you know, the third thing Mission Control talks about, if I hadn't cut the picture out, is a digital voice recorder. Although we really don't have to do that anymore, right, with our smartphones. Now, the challenging thing with that is if I'm in a meeting and something else comes to mind, and I don't want to say, oh, remind my husband to do something. I don't want to say that out loud. You know, it's easier to capture it. But even if you're in meetings and something comes to mind, if you capture it, it's instantly off your mind. And you actually can be with the person you're with. The more you implement the things that we're talking about, the more present you'll be able to be with people. So what I'm suggesting is that you have one and only one capture tool. And the practice is, you immediately enter everything into your Mission Control system through one and only one capture tool. It's simple. It may seem like a lot, right? But if you just took on the next day or two, anytime something comes to mind, the list will end. It's not infinite. Now, it feels like it's infinite, doesn't it? Doesn't it feel like it'll, I mean, y'all stopped writing. Did you notice the room stopped? And so, I stopped with you. It's like, well, I'm not going to go there if we're done, right? But why do we stop? Is because it's more than we can comfortably confront. But if you're going to have a breakthrough, what did I tell you earlier? You remember what I said? You got to face reality. Now, you don't have to. You've been successful. You're here in the room. But if you want what you said you wanted out of being here, it's going to take you looking at things newly. And so capturing anything to do or handle. So this is the practice. You immediately, and I like having the phone because we always have our phones with us, right? So those of you that always have your phone, it's simple. You can rely on it. I captured in my notes section and instantly I could be with you now. I'm not worried about, am I going to remember that? What am I to tell her? Right? Now, if I can delegate it, so if Pamela is my assistant and I immediately, it comes to mind and I give it to Pamela, and I know Pamela is completely trustworthy, I don't write it down. It's now hers, it's off my mind. So if you can delegate it to somebody that you know long enough that you're reliable to do what they say, and it doesn't create any stress for you because you know they're going to do it, you can just not write it down. Or if you do it, let's just say I say I want to talk to Allie and I text Allie and she calls me right back. I don't need to write it down, right? It happened. And so the practice is you have one and only one capture tool. Now, this is not your note-taking pad. If you're a person that likes to take notes, great. But that's not this. Now, I did have you take notes at the beginning because that's what we had. But the tool is just a tool for capturing the things you have to do or handle. That's all. So if you like to take notes, make sure you have, if you're using a pad, get you a different pad. Because what happens when we do that? You can't find it. Have you ever been through your notes and you're like, I know I put a star or an extra special symbol. Oh, but I did another symbol here. And oh, I doodled there, right? Yeah. It's not your note-taking page. And we did that. We already did that. So nothing for you to do or handle is stored in your memory or exist on post-it notes or scraps of paper or backs of napkins or notes on memos or letters or scattered around in various places. And maybe, but not always, found in your phone. Oh, here's the picture. I told you I had a picture. I don't know if it was an out of order. So this is some very that's an old picture. Blackberry. They still have blackberries. Do y'all have blackberries? No. So these, you know, this is what Mission Control recommends. So I'd like you to take a moment and decide how many of you will take on this as a practice. How many of you will take, like, just trying it on. Yeah, you know, you will fail initially because you have habits, right? You'll do, you know, you'll have, anybody a post-it notes person here? Yeah, when I did Mission Control, I swore I needed to be in the post-it notes ownership. I needed, I don't know, if, you know, what is it, 3M? Yeah, I needed to have their stock because when we were out of post-it notes, it was like tragedy in my company. So I would have post-it notes on my computer. I'd have them in my car. I'd have them in my office. Do you know we don't have post-it notes in our office anymore? It just went away when I started doing this. It's funny because I asked Brenda for a post-it note. She goes, you know we don't have post-it notes. We have those little signature things, right, because we use those. But we just don't have post-it notes. Now, those things will go away. Now, for some of you, it'll be like cutting off an arm, and I would have thought that it would cut off my arm if you told me I wasn't going to use post-it notes, I would not believe you. But it was a natural occurrence of taking on this practice. So number two is to have your tool, capture tool with you all the time, ready to hand. This is the most critical practice. Why do we say that? Why do we say that? Why do you say it's important to have it ready to hand?
Because if you don't, then
you'll go back to your habits, right? You'll go back and write it down or write it on a paper or say, oh, I'll remember that. So you want to keep it. That's the first practice is to keep your. I can't tell you how many I lost when I first started doing this. And then I bought small, pretty ones because I wanted pretty ones. So I bought, because that was before, you know, the phones had all the cool stuff when I first started doing it. So I ordered some that would fit in my purse. And I can't tell you how many times my assistant Brenda would be calling restaurants. Did you find a little notepad with pink flowers on it? Because I would lose it everywhere. And then I would go crazy, you know. But I have to tell you, it took me a while to get that habit. It's a new habit you're creating. So you want to be being a beginner with this stuff. I know you're really smart people. And this sounds really elementary, and on some level, it's very elegant and simple. But it takes changing your habit. Have you ever tried to change a habit? How easy is it? Yeah, this will take persistence. We talked about this, about when things come up. And then practice number four is empty your capture tool every day. Now, we don't have the whole system yet, so let me tell you the practice that I'm recommending. With what you've got, the knowledge you have right now, because I'm not going to, you know, kill you with anything else. And that is, look through your capture tool every day and decide what's important and schedule the time to complete it in your calendar. Did you hear what I said? This is important. So every day, you want to look at your capture tool and you want to go through and you want to choose the items that you're actually going to do. By scheduling them in your calendar with a sufficient time to complete them. Sherry, you're looking at me. I know, I recognize that face because that was me. In fact, I had my head on the table when they were telling me this. I was like, listen, if I can do it, I'm the one that, you know, picked up my child late, forgot my child, right? So if I can do it, anybody can do it. I promise you. Just take on one piece. Every day, I want you to look at your capture tool and I want you to choose. Now, what you'll find is the things that are most important will naturally rise to the top. And you'll start to confront the things that maybe aren't going to get done. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Do you block off a lunch break for yourself? Yeah. Do you sporadically change it during the week, or do you always?
Oh, at the same time?
Same time.
I don't, because I travel from client to client. So I do, and a lot of times I'll have lunch with clients. But if it's something you want to do, if eating is important to you, if I think eating is important, then you want to schedule the time for it. And if you can do it, if it works for you to schedule a reoccurring every day because of the environment, absolutely. You know, drive time. It's going to take you time to drive things. So do you have time in your calendar for driving? You know, is there, now, and I'm not suggesting that you fill your, you fill the calendar, you know, from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. or 6 p.m. or whatever your time is with all the things from your capture tool. Why do I say that? Because it won't get done, because you're going to have interruptions and you're going to have emergencies and you got to go to the bathroom and you need to get a cup of coffee, and right? And you do need, this also doesn't, this might be where you're at, Sherry. I relate to you, I don't know, because I live with yellow energy, right? When I first started hearing about this, I completely reacted. Because it was like, well, what about spontaneity? What about fun? Listen, you can create a day for spontaneity and fun. The thing is that you create this. It's your calendar. My experience, I will tell you, my experience today from implementing this is I'm actually creating my life versus being a reaction to life. I was just reacting. Start to notice for yourself. You know, Sijan, when he talked about the evening, you can see there's a piece of creating he's doing there. He said, my life in the evening's different. I'm doing this and this and this in the evening. I'm not doing that.
You guys will never know.
Right? And I'd like you to consider that what we've said to ourselves, like me saying I'm not a banker, what we've said about ourselves is about what's possible isn't true. You don't even know what's true. You know, I'm not in your shoes, and I don't know your work, right? So you'll have to. But you're a smart person, and you'll have to look for yourself. The thing that I was responding to is people. You know, listen. Just like when I told the bankers I'm leaving at 8 o'clock, I'm not staying till 8 o'clock anymore. They weren't. They were leaving at 5 o'clock. And we were a $4.5 billion company. I was doing whatever I was doing, right? I mean, I didn't feel like I was messing around. I was very committed to my job. But so it's very difficult to look at other people and evaluate ourselves on them. All I can evaluate is on what I know and what I'm accomplishing. And so that's what I was reacting to, is I don't know if you're getting things done, but it is possible that you are. Or it's possible that you're creating your life that says, I'm going to work as hard as I can from this time to this time, and unless it's urgent, and sometimes we all have to work late, right? That's just life. But it doesn't have to be every day. Did that respond to what you're saying? Yeah. You won't necessarily like reality. You won't like that you can't get it all done. That is when you. One of the things you're going to see when you put this in your calendar, it isn't going to fit. You are not going to get it all done. Now, I know that's interesting to consider, but you're not getting it all done now. Look at your list. I'm talking about the whole thing, right? All the letters you want to write, all the books you want to read, all one of the programs you want to learn. Some things dropping out because it doesn't fit and we're not telling the truth about it. What if you actually told the truth about it? But listen, I still don't like it. I'll catch myself. So the context that you and I live inside of is we're going to get it all done. And we're good people. And good people should get it all done, and we're failures if we don't. But the problem is you're not. And so we're fooling ourselves. So if you actually, from anything I've said today, if you could actually just get in touch with the truth, oops, it's 133. The truth, I apologize, one more minute. The truth that you're not going to get it all done. Then it has you start to confront, well, what am I going to do? And the most important things will rise to the top. And it may take some conversations. Because you've got to be responsible for the things on your list. You say, oh, Mammy said we're not going to get it all done. So, you know, forget that. I'm going to mark that sucker off. Woo-hoo. You know, and then Allie or Chris or David comes and says, well, what happened? Right? So I'm not saying don't be responsible. But what I want you to get, this is the beginning of the breakthrough that we talked about, is getting in reality. I still will catch myself trying to get it all done. I will. I'll have 10 minutes in between two things and I'll tell my assistant, oh yeah, put them in there. Really? Then I'm trying to rush a 10-minute conversation in between, and if I have to go to the bathroom and get a drink, just forget it. You're not going to get it all done. And there's a lot of things to do. And there will always be a lot of things to do. But the thing that I pray for you is that you actually start to look to see so that you can actually create the life that matters to you, that has you have the excellence that you're committed to. I know who's in this room. I've been with you. This is not a room of slackers. You're up to something. And you get frustrated when you don't accomplish everything you know you could. But the problem is that the measure that you have it against isn't accurate. Because your expectation is I'm going to get all of it done and it's going to be done right. And then you set yourself up for overwhelm and frustration. That's why you stop. So the context that we to start to consider, and as we do other lunch and learns related to this, is, you know, to really start to confront, I'm never going to get it all done, like really. And if I'm not, then what am I actually going to do? And what will I actually schedule in my calendar to accomplish? Not a list of things down here that I don't know how long they take, but actually looking to see what am I those lists am I actually going to do and I'm actually going to put in my calendar. I can see you're listening, right? You're processing. So I just really want to thank you for the opportunity. I know I've given you a lot to consider today. I know it's been a lot. I told you at the beginning I wanted to give you as much as I can. I trust that the right thing that you needed to hear, you'll have gotten. If you have questions, again, you're welcome. I know y'all know how to get a hold of me. Allie's got my information. Pam's got my information if you don't. And so the first practice is capture tool. Start capturing things. The second practice is what are you going to schedule? And then the third practice is look at agendas. Can I create agendas for people that regularly interrupt me or I regularly interrupt so that we are reducing the amount of time we interrupt people? And listen, if you get frustrated with a tight schedule, listen, we have hooky days in my company. There's days when I'll come in and I'll have rescheduled things and not told my assistant and said we're playing hooky because I have to have days for spontaneity and not structure because that's kind of how I'm wired. So I have I have times where I schedule fun. I actually schedule fun. If you're not having fun in your life, there's got to be time in your calendar for it to happen. If you're not exercising, there's not time in your calendar for it to happen. You see a theme here? Yeah. Questions?